and sing, I know whom I have believed. I know who I have believed. Let's all stand to our feet as we sing praise to the Lord. Let's lift our voices.
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me he has made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed me for his own. But I know I have believed and am persuaded that he is
to the Lord in prayer at this time and ask God's blessing upon you, this church, his blessing upon this nation. We ask God to intervene in the affairs that regard our people, this nation, and we are so happy in the Lord to be with you. While we're doing that, Jonathan, let me get you to come over. I've been trying to get your attention. You haven't seen me there. All right. Help me with the sound. I don't have enough. Amen. It's not close. All right. Let's bow our heads for prayer at this time. Let's go to the Lord. Let us pray. Dear Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your goodness and all that you've done. We ask for your blessing, your presence. Lord God, we pray that you would manifest your power amongst us, Lord God, that you would speak to us, dear Father. And Lord, we need you. We need you. Lord God, we need you in our homes. We need you in our streets, in our communities, in our nation. Dear Father, we pray that you would bless your word, bless the worship, and bless the families that are represented. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let me ask you to remain standing, and we will sing. No, it was on. The wire was loose. Now I see. All right. Thank you. All right. We will sing Saved, Saved. something, for I'm saved, saved, saved. When poor and needy and all alone, in love He said to me, come on to me, and I'll a few brief announcements. Brother Ocasio, it's good to see you. How about you come over here and greet the church family? I'm going to make a couple more announcements behind you. I'm going to just catch everything you leave out. Amen?
Okay.
All right. Go for it.
You have to hold the mic really close.
All right. Thank
you, brother. Got any spray here or something?
Oh, yeah. Right? Well, not too close.
Seeing the family again. Sorry we missed you last week. And I'm glad we didn't go to Los Angeles. We were supposed to be in Los Angeles, but we canceled that. And we celebrated just our anniversary, 34 years marriage. And plus my birthday's coming up on the 2nd, so.
Amen.
I got a big whammy coming up. Anyway, Pastor, I was gonna ask you, are we going to have our 6th anniversary banquet?
We're gonna have our 6th anniversary. Amen. We will.
Okay. I'm just curious because you never mentioned it. I don't know if we have to come back from Puerto Rico for that, so that sounds good. Listen, I want to thank you. Everything is going well. Pastor showed me a location, a beautiful location, for us to pray about. But there's many more coming now with the coronavirus. Pray that we find a location. There's a lot of locations that are available. A lot of businesses will not reopen. So we have great opportunities for that. And I just want to share that with you. And the good news is that it's available, and the challenging news is that we need the money. So pray about $2 to $4 million, okay? That's nothing for God. With the Lord, all things are possible on that. And I just want to share the scriptures with you for the week. It's Jeremiah 29:11-13. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. You know, that's very good. See, God knows the thoughts of us, but not the evil part. He already knows the good part. He knows all of it, but the good part, the encouraging part for us, and we know our end. And our end is that we're going to be with the Lord, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in heaven. The battle is won. The war is won. The battle rages on earth. It says, then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me, when ye shall search for me with all your heart. See, people are searching for God, but not with their heart. They're searching for God to get cured. They're searching for many different things, but are they searching with the heart? And that's how God, if we find God, we're still in the time of grace, the church age. So let's be mindful of that. There are people suffering right now. People are dying. We don't know if they're saved or not, but be kind. Be kind to people. And remember that you're saved and it's sealed, but a lot of people are not. So let's think about others, and God will worry about your business if you take care of his business. With that, let me turn it back to Pastor because he's got a lot of things to say.
Amen. Thank you, brother. So if you check into your bulletins, you'll see that we have some special days coming up. And this Saturday, we're having a special day of evangelism. And we're calling it Sound the Trumpet. And we're living in a day-to-day where churches are... Many churches have their doors closed, and the Lord has allowed us to get our doors back open. And we're living in a day where people need the gospel. And we have the command from the Lord Jesus Christ to go ye therefore and teach all nations. And so we're inviting our church family to come out on that day to go soul winning, street preaching, evangelizing. And we'll be handing out tracts. We'll be preaching the gospel that day together. We'll be meeting at Prospect Park on the southeast entrance. So that is at Ocean Avenue in Parkside. And so I trust that you'll show up on that day. And later on in the service, we're going to take a head count at 10 o'clock. We're going to take a head count of how many people we'll be expecting. We'll have some refreshments for the 12 o'clock hour. And so we're looking forward to that day greatly. Also, as you know, this is not all of our church family. With every passing Sunday, we have someone new coming back that has been away since the coronavirus outbreak, pandemic, crisis has taken place. And so we have a few of you who are back for the first time since that time, and we welcome you back. On next Sunday, we are going to be encouraging everybody to come back. And ushers, if you would, get the seating prepared. We got more folks coming in. Let's be ahead of the ball game there with the seating. All right, Brother Casio, those are your guys. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. And again, we're encouraging everyone to invite guests. And now, there's this thing you may have heard of called social distancing, all right? And it's already pretty full in this room right now. But if you analyze, you'll see that we're actually properly distanced as is right now. And I just called out the ushers a minute ago, but the ushers have done a good job setting up the seating so that we have the proper distance. So we're actually in quite good shape. Now you're saying, Pastor, the room is full. How are we going to get all these more people in? Well, friends, we have more space up here in the front. Next Sunday, I'm going to roll this pulpit back. We're going to have room for another 20 or 30, and we'll all be properly distanced, and we are going to rejoice and praise God together. And I am excited. I am so excited about what God is doing for our church and in our church. And I want everyone to understand in this room that this church has a role within this community. Family Baptist Church has a role, a vital role within the kingdom of God. Again, soul winning, evangelism. This is not optional as far as a command of Jesus Christ. It is a command. And so I encourage you to show up for Saturday, and for Sunday, we are looking forward to rejoicing in Christ together. We'll have preaching, we'll have refreshments, we will be taking volunteers. We'll have some announcements on the end. We'll need volunteers to bring things in, and so again, we are looking forward to that special day. With all of that, we are going to sing. I'll ask you to stand again. And we will sing Jesus I Come. Let's all stand to our feet. We'll sing this beautiful song. Jesus, I come. Let's sing. Out of my bondage, sorrow and night, Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Out of my sickness, into thy help, Jesus, I come. Family, what you don't know is I'm getting to a place in my life where I'm starting to need glasses. No, I just need glasses. So if you notice, I missed my place on the page. And sometimes when I'm reading at night, I'm struggling. I can't see like before. Can you imagine? One Sunday, I'm just going to show up. You're going to see. Amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. God bless you. At this time, we're going to receive the offering this morning, and we are grateful to our church family here. You give and support the church so that we could run the bus, we could pay the rent here, and so on. We give God the glory for the wonderful church family that we have here. Let's bow for prayer and ask God's blessing on the offering this morning. Dear Father, thank you for this day. Once again, thank you for your goodness, Lord. Not only did you wake us up this morning, but Lord, as we look around, everything that we have, Lord God, it was given out of your benevolent hand. Thank you, dear Father. We love you, dear Father. Lord, help us to worship you by giving back to you that which is already yours, Lord God, the tenth. And Lord, we just pray that this offering would be blessed, that the church would prosper, Lord, that we can, Lord, get our own facility one day so that we can just do more ministry, preaching the gospel, Lord God, obeying your command to not only teach all nations, but to baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And Lord, we can't do it without you. We need your help. Lord God, help us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Life becomes a shattered dream that's slipping through my trembling hands. I need to know that you are near, to know that you see each falling tear. When there is no one else who understands, when I can't find the words to speak, you feel the pain in each heartbeat. Before I even run to you, in my deepest hour of need, that's when you come and pour your mercy on me. Your beauty shines, your love surrounds, where cries of brokenness are found. Bring hope alive, help me believe, and trust you one more time in brokenness. You shine in brokenness. You shine. Let comfort be a living thing that's slipping through my earth's trembling hands, where thirsty souls can drink their fill in their deepest hour of need. It's when you come and pour your mercy on me. Your beauty shines, your love surrounds, where cries of brokenness are found. Bring hope alive, help me believe, and trust you one more time. In brokenness, you shine. How could I know when others said a word or two, then walked away, that you, the man of sorrows, would come near to stay? You always stay. Help me.
In our brokenness that we see Christ in ways that you could not see him otherwise. And so, if you have your Bibles, let me ask you to turn to the book of Matthew, the gospel according to Matthew. And where is my friend Jonathan? Let me get you to come one more time, or two more times, amen? There he is, come on over. If you would, play around with this for me, please. And batteries are there. Those are not my batteries. Thank you. All right. See if you could work that out for me there. Praise the Lord. All right. They say good help is hard to find, but we have good help. Amen. Praise the Lord. Whoever said that, by the way. All right. They didn't come to our church. They don't know what's going on. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, we'll be reading Matthew chapter 18, verses 5 through 10. We will be doing our responsive scripture reading also. I'll read the verse 5 and you'll join me on verse 6 and we'll continue in that pattern. All right, and ushers again. All right, always set out a couple of extra chairs, all right, ahead of who comes in. Amen. All right, so Matthew chapter 18, verse number 5. Let's all stand for the reading of God's word this morning. The Bible says, "And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name receiveth me. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe unto the world because of offenses, for it must needs be that offenses come. But woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. Wherefore, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life with one eye, rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. Take heed that ye despise not one of these little ones, for I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven." Let's go to the Lord one more time in prayer and ask his blessing on the preaching this morning. Dear Father, again, we come to you, Lord. It is you who is our source for all things, Lord God. I could not stand here if it were not for you to give me the strength to stand, the skill in my tongue to speak, to do anything, Lord. It is from you. Dear Father, we ask your blessing on the message. Lord God, help us to capture the truth that you have for us. Speak to us, Lord God, so that we might be aligned with your will, so that our lives might be conformed to the image of your Son, and that our lives may bring you glory. We want our lives to bring you glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for standing with us this morning. As I so often do say, I will utter it again. It is my distinct honor and privilege to welcome you to this house of worship, this temple of prayer, this house of prayer. You know the scripture, "My house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer." When God called me, little old me, to preach at the age of 15 years old, I confess to you that I was reluctant. I didn't understand. To just be plain about it, I just didn't want it. I didn't want to do it. And I was always a shy young child, and I think I'm a shy young man still. And yes, I'm young. That's right. Okay? For anyone wondering. Don't let these gray hairs fool you. Amen? All right? I didn't really want it. But I tell you this. Had I known then how great the feeling would be, had I known how greatly blessed that I would be in this moment in my life, I would have jumped at the chance. I would have leaped for joy having been called to preach. And I am so glad God called me into the ministry. I am so happy about that. Thank you. There is great joy. Oh, you see the difference? Amen. Praise God. All right? It is great joy to serve God. There is nothing like it. You tell me what activity there is out there, and I will promise you, and I will confess to you, and declare that that activity cannot compare to the glory it is to serve Christ. There is nothing greater than serving Christ. Amen. I would beg, if God didn't call me to preach, if I knew then what I know now, I'd beg God, God, please call me to preach. Please pick me, pick me. Amen. He did pick me. Glory to God. And I choose to serve him. Amen. In the manner that I do, as he directs me. As you know, as you've kind of figured out, the pastor likes to sing. Amen. And I love the hymns. Amen. Even when I get the verses confused, amen, just a little bit, but I love to sing them. There's nothing like them. And that's not to throw shade at the new songs. There are a lot of good new songs out there, but you can't replace the old songs for the new songs, amen. You're gonna cast aside blessed assurance? Are you kidding me? Victory in Jesus? No. No, you can't do that. Amen. The old songs stay. Amen. You want to sprinkle in a couple new ones? Have at it. Amen. There was a day where the old songs used to be new songs. All right. So we recognize there's a value in having a new song or two. But you cannot just cast aside the classics. They're just so wonderful. And I love to sing them. I remember as a high schooler being at home, I remember getting my hands on a hymn book, amen? And I would sit at home and I would sing the hymns at home. That's what I tested my voice against, amen? I would practice and I was having a great time at home. My poor dear family was suffering through that. Me singing loud at the top of my lungs, God bless them, amen? They endured all that. It's great joy to serve Christ. It's great joy to serve him. We have this day before us a very remarkable passage of Scripture. And I say it's remarkable. You see, all of the Scripture is alive. Amen. For the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of sword and spirit, and so on. All right, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. But this scripture kind of stands out just a bit because, let's just say, it's explicit. It's graphic. It's a graphic little scripture right here. If you're going to offend one of these little ones, here's what you do. You take this big old millstone, right? This huge rock that you would not have the strength to lift up on your own. You tie a rope to that millstone. You take the other end of that rope and you wrap it around your neck real tight. And then you just throw that millstone. Now, first of all, you probably wouldn't be able to pick up a millstone. So there's a little hyperbole, a little figurative language here, so to speak. He's exaggerating. But you'll understand the point. If you had the strength, you take that millstone, you cast it in the sea. And, of course, that means you're going to drown in the sea. And that would be better for you than to offend one of these little ones. Very explicit, don't you think? I think so. And, of course, the scripture expresses, please, nobody tie a heavy object to your neck and throw yourself in the sea. Please, no one in this room do that. All right, if you're listening on Facebook Live, please don't do that. Amen. And I feel a need for it. I might say it in a kind of a funny way, maybe tongue in cheek, don't do that. And maybe that will be a type of humor. But the reality is, we're living in a day where people are considering taking their life. And as a Christian, we need to be sensitive to that and understand that there's a lot of people around us who are suffering inwardly, and they're seeking for answers. They're trying to find meaning in their life. And for any of you that might have that on your heart and on your mind, I'm going to tell you right now, there is great meaning to life. It's all about Jesus Christ. And when you find him, when you put him in the forefront of your life, you'll find out
there's nothing greater. There's nothing more important. There's nothing that supersedes serving Christ. There's no one decision that is greater than accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. There's nothing greater. But that's not the message so much this morning. Again, we're dealing with a very graphic piece of scripture before us. Not only does it talk about a millstone, but it basically expresses here, let's take a look at verse number 7. Woe unto the world because of offenses, for it must needs be that offenses come. But woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. So in the world that we live in, bad things are going to happen. Offenses must come. People are going to get hurt and so on. But woe unto the person who is responsible for inflicting that hurt. And it says following, wherefore if thy hand offend, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life, halt or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. Whoa! Again, no one go leave church and say to yourself, you know what, I have a problem with my hands, I have a problem with my feet, I'm going to cut off my hands, I'm going to cut off my feet. Don't do that. Understand what Jesus is saying. He says it very explicitly, very graphically. He's talking about removing hands and feet. He says, cut off your hands or your feet and cast it from you. It would be better to do that than to offend one of God's dear children. What's interesting about this scripture is if you would turn with me to Matthew chapter 5. Turn to Matthew chapter 5. All right, Matthew 5, and look with me at verse number 28. Many of you know this scripture. If you've been reading your Bible a while, you've heard this before. Check this out with me. Verse 28 and 29. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. Did you catch it? Do you see it? It's the same type of graphic language that we just read in Matthew 18, but it's applied to a completely different sin, a whole totally different concept. Now we're talking about a man lusting after a woman, and if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out. If thy hand offend thee, cut it off. If thy foot offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee. And now we look at Matthew 18. It talks about offending God's little ones, God's children. And if you would be such an one that would offend one of God's little ones that believe in Christ, it were better for thee to tie a millstone about your neck, be cast into the sea. It would be better for you to cut off your hand or your foot, cast it from you. It would be better for you to enter into heaven, enter into life, maimed or halt, than to go to hell with two hands and two feet. Wow. I don't know about you, but that is some powerful language. That is highly graphic and explicit. Listen, we're living in some tough times in our nation, aren't we? Some tough times. And last week we had the Republican National Convention. We had the Democratic National Convention a week before that. In November, we're going to elect a new president or re-elect the one that we have. Let me just say with you this morning that when the first Republican president was elected, oh, so many years ago, it was well known about him that he stood against the evil of slavery. And of course, the whole nation knew that he was abolitionist. That's what they called him, against slavery. So when he did get elected in 1861, the southern states that were holding slaves broke away from the Union. They rebelled against the nation because they saw they could read the writing on the wall. We're going to need more seats. They can read the writing on the wall, and they understand that soon slavery is going to be done away with in the nation. So they said, you know what? We're going to break away from the Union. And so it was April the 12th, 1861, the Southern Confederate Army attacked Fort Sumter. And that marked the beginning of the Civil War. Many of us don't know a lot about the Civil War unless you sat in the classroom and you studied history. I just want you to know this about the war, that as far as casualties in the war, and I'm talking about in battle, from disease amongst troops, from civilian casualties, all of that, the casualties in the war number between 640,000 to 700,000 souls. The Civil War is the bloodiest war that the United States has ever been in. And the second bloodiest war happened to be World War II, where well over 200,000 of American troops died. Compare that, 200,000 to 700,000. The Civil War, before the days of machine guns and so on, was so much deadlier, so much bloodier than any other war that the United States has ever been in to this day. The cause was noble. The point was to free the slaves and to save the Union, to save the United States of America. But it came at a very high cost. If you understand the carnage and the blood and the death that took place during the Civil War in this nation, you would come to the conclusion that it was this war where America paid for her sins. Aside from the countless death you had and the horrific injuries that soldiers were experiencing, it was at this time that they had a special bullet that was used among the French army. They called it the Mignon, after General Mignon. This particular bullet was slow moving, coming out of those rifles. And when it would hit a soldier, it would create so much blunt force damage to the body. And if it hit the bone would absolutely shatter. And so the Civil War was absolutely brutal. You know the number one surgery performed during the Civil War? It was amputation. It was amputation. And so the days before anesthesia, here's what I thought. I thought, before I got prepared for this message, I thought they had no painkillers in those days. And they did these. Can you imagine having a limb removed? A leg, an arm, and so on? A hand, a foot? With no painkiller at all, they did have chloroform. Sometimes they would mess up with the chloroform. With too much of the chloroform, the patient would go into cardiac arrest and would die from the chloroform. But the chloroform was enough to put that patient to sleep. Amputations. Amputations. Without an amputation, that injury would get infected, would turn into gangrene, and they would die from the infection. The amputations were necessary. If an amputation was done properly, wow. When you got up this morning and came to church, you didn't know we'd be talking about these medical terms
today. All right? Pastor, that's why I never wanted to get into the medical field. I can't stand the sight of blood. We're talking about amputations in church. Amen. All right? All right, so if an amputation was done properly, the chances of a soldier surviving from the surgery was about 75%. The chances were good, and depending on where that amputation was. So if your amputation was just your hand, your chances of survival were much better than if your amputation was up at the shoulder. If your amputation was down below your knee or just your foot, your chances of survival were much better than if your amputation went all the way up to your hip. And they did a lot of those. A lot of them were all the way up at the shoulder. A lot of them were all the way at the hip. But the whole point was so that they could save that man's life. That was the whole point. Without that surgery, as gruesome as the concept would be, listen, I think about that. I see people. I have a pastor friend, Pastor Phil Rizzo, a great man of God. He pastors City Baptist Church in Hoboken, New Jersey, just on the other side of the Hudson River. And he's unique. He happens to be without an arm up to his elbow. I forget if it's his left or right, but that's Pastor Rizzo for you. And he lost an arm. I have another pastor friend who is an amputee, Pastor Tom Bish. Many of you had met him. He was even my teacher at International Bible College for a time, a great man of God, and a time in his life when his church was doing great and he was successful in the ministry. And by the way, they have an incredible testimony. Their church didn't have a building, and they were able to buy a school building from that township in Wallingford, Connecticut, and they bought their church building for $1. And they meet in that church building to this day. Listen to me. You can't tell me that God can't provide a building for this church. We've seen God do miracles, and God has another miracle yet in store. You're going to see. Anyway, continuing on, my dear friend, Pastor Bish, when things were going great in the ministry, he came down with cancer. And it was in his leg. They had to amputate his leg. But guess what? It saved his life. That was many years ago. That's well over 10 or more years ago. To this day, I suppose, while I'm preaching right here, Pastor Bish, with his prosthetic and his other good leg, he stands in his pulpit this morning preaching the word of God. Amen. And let me tell you something else about him. A dear pastor friend, a great man of God, a great preacher. He had to say goodbye to his dear wife, Katrina. Said goodbye to his dear wife. She too came down with cancer, and she did not survive. And it's been closing in on 2 years. But here's the thing about all of that. He knows in the recess of his heart that one day he's going to heaven and he will see his dear wife again. We have that hope in Jesus Christ. Precious in the sight of the Lord are the death of his saints. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You may say goodbye to someone here on this realm, but when we get to heaven, I'm telling you, it's going to be hello. It's going to be a great reunion in God's kingdom in heaven. But that's not the message so much this morning. Again, he's a survivor of a procedure called amputation. Again, pretty graphic stuff. And the Civil War had lots of amputations, lots of them. Again, with casualties of people, soldiers dying and people dying, upwards of 700,000. Can you imagine how many, many tens of thousands of these amputation surgeries that they performed? It's countless. I did my little research. I do like you. I go on Google and I just look at amputation, Civil War, photographs from 1860s of the survivors of these surgeries. Quite amazing stuff. On a far more barbaric note, I'm going to save that point for later. Let's continue on. Between you and me, I'm not trying to be irreverent, but I can't really say that I appreciate this particular passage on a personal level. It's just a little too graphic for me, if you don't mind me say so. But this passage is so important, and we need to understand the message that Jesus Christ is saying to us. And using this illustration two times with two completely different concepts. First of all, again, they're two completely different concepts. One is about sinning as far as lust, and the other one is about offending one of God's little children. The point is this, we're not supposed to sin. And if there's anything in your life that you know is that thing that leads you back into a sin that you should not be in, that is something that you need to cut out from your life and cast it from you. Now think about this. Who wants to say goodbye to their right arm? Not me, my friends. I just want to let you know this morning, I happen to be right-handed. And if you see me write a letter with my pen, I write script, I've been told I have pretty nice handwriting. Amen? I don't know what I'll do without my right hand, my right arm. I'm not trying to say goodbye to my right arm. Jesus is not telling any one of us to literally run to a Kings County Hospital or Methodist and ask the doctor for an amputation. That's not what Jesus is saying. What Jesus is saying is that you take the dearest thing to you, the thing that you cherish the most. It might be your right arm. It might be your right leg. It might be one of your eyes. And don't let anything be so dear to you, so precious to you, that you can't say goodbye to it. If it's hurting you, if it's causing you to sin, if it's taking you down a wrong path, do you understand? Cut it off and cast it from thee. It's better for you to go on and live a life in Christ and walk with God and serve God than to keep that thing in your life, to keep that sin in your life. It is better for you to cut that thing out of your life so that you can serve Christ the way you're supposed to. There are things in our lives we need to say goodbye to. Again, don't get nervous this morning. You don't have to cut your arm off. Praise God. No one needs to be plucking any eyes out. Amen. By the way, there's a great man of God, great music pastor, great music minister of the Lord. Many of you know him as Patch the Pirate. Many of you know him by his name, Ron Hamilton. And I love his music, and he's still with us today. But there was a day where he was in the ministry down there in South Carolina serving Christ. And one day he was having trouble with his eyes. And he went in for a checkup. They found cancer in his eye. To save his life, you know what they had to do? They had to remove the eye. After his recovery and he returned back to church, he came to church with a patch. The kids would see him at the church and say, "Wow, you have a patch. Are you a pirate now?" And that's how he got the nickname, Patch the Pirate. And from then on, he had much music ministry to children. And he wrote those Patch the Pirate stories, him and his wife and his children participating in that wonderful ministry for well over the 30 or 40 years. God's blessed him mightily. But before the blessing came, he had to say goodbye to the eye. It was to save his life. It was to save his life. Some of us have friends and associations that it is through that friend that the devil uses them to pull you down. You know what you need to do, right? Cut it off. Cast it from thee. It would be better for you to enter into life without that friend than to be dragged down a pathway you should not be going. Something that would separate you from your fellowship with Christ. Something that will cause you to fail to achieve the will of God for your life. It would be better for you to say goodbye to that friend than to be going on with that friend and then you fail. You fail to achieve the heights that the Lord would have for you. It might be a particular pet sin in your life. It says in Hebrews chapter 12, "Let us therefore run the race and lay aside the weight that's
that does so easily beset us. We need to lay aside the weights. You might have a pursuit in your life. It's not a sin. There's nothing wrong with it. But with that particular thing in your life, you are not able to follow Christ the way you're supposed to. It has become such a distraction for you. Somehow your affections have wrapped itself all around that one thing, and you can't seem to find time for Christ. You can't seem to find a way to serve God the way you're supposed to. Well, you might have to say goodbye to that thing. You might have to say goodbye to that thing. Again, over the years, I've grown quite fond of my right arm. I hate to say goodbye to my right arm. Amen. I hate to say goodbye to my right leg. And I tell you what, in all fairness, I say my right arm, I kind of like my left one too. Amen. I'd like to keep both of them if you don't mind. Is that all right with you? Well, you know, can you imagine yourself going through life with one arm or one leg? I'm not fond of that idea at all. I don't like it. I don't like it. Pluck out my eye, cut off my arm, cut off, I don't like it. Stop, preacher. I don't like this sermon. Last week's sermon was better. Why are you talking about this? Hey, it is tough to think about. It's tough to think about. That's my emotion talking. Okay, I like my right arm. I like my left arm. But that's my emotion talking. What if my life depended on it? What if I got cancer in one of my arms? Then what? Well, it would be better to lose that arm to save your life. You get that? You understand? It is better to remove something in your life that you don't need so that the greater good can be accomplished. My emotion doesn't want to say goodbye to that thing. However, my logical mind says otherwise. Jesus is talking logic. It is better for you to go to heaven with one hand than to go to hell with two hands. It is better to go to heaven with one eye than to go to hell with two eyes. It is better to go to heaven with one foot, one leg, than go to hell with two. What's the point of keeping both arms and you go to hell with them? There's no point in that. Amen? Wouldn't it be better to enter into heaven with one of them than to go to hell with two? This is extreme. So extreme. But we have things in our lives that we don't want to let go of. Again, some of us have bad friends. Some of these things are besetting sins. Some of them are shameful habits. My church family, I tell you this morning, cut it off. Cast it from thee. It's not enough to cut it off. Okay, I'll cut it off. No. You have to cut it off and cast it from you. That's what Jesus said. It says, if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. Pluck it out and cast it from thee. Get it away from you as far as you can. Back to the Civil War, when they did one of these horrific surgeries, one of these gruesome surgeries, and they took an arm or a leg or whatever, a hand, a foot, you couldn't keep that foot there, that dead foot. That would bring disease. That would get the patient sick. The patient has an open wound. That patient could get infected. You had literally had to get rid of that foot. You couldn't keep that foot around. It's cut it off and cast it from you. It's to cast it off like it's a hateful thing, but it's something that we might love and cherish. It's my arm, but it doesn't matter. You have to get rid of it. You have to get rid of it. It's not enough to cut it off. You got to cast it from you. It'll infect you. It'll get you sick. It'll still bring death to you. Cast it away as though it were a hateful thing. The difficult and necessary decision to take the arm or take the leg is difficult.
It's difficult. And like it is difficult to say goodbye, it is difficult to say goodbye to something that's so dear to us, like an arm or a leg, or something bad that we've enjoyed in our lives for years and years in our lives. But the point is that it's life-saving. Another point I want to share with you is that there is a time factor. If you were on the battlefield and you got hit by one of those horrific rounds and it shattered your bone and you have a putrefying, bleeding wound and you're on the battlefield, they need to turn to you quick. They need to get to you quick. We have a nurse here. I forgot. We got a medical professional here. Amen. All right. She can correct me at any point in the sermon. Amen. Okay. I'm no expert. Yeah, thank you, sister. All right. Hey, listen to me. You get one of those horrific injuries, then you get to you quick. We need to deal with that blood loss. Amen. We need to get you a tourniquet real fast. We need to get urgent care to you. There's a time factor involved. You might be sitting here this morning and you're hearing the message and I don't know who I'm speaking to. You know what? I tell you, when I prepare these messages, I pray to God. I'm like, God, what do you want for the people to hear? And when I came upon this scripture, I can tell you this. I've been reading this scripture just about all my Christian life. I've been saved more than 30 years or so. Never did I have a desire, or never did I ever have it in my mind that I wanted to preach about this. But this week, the Lord said, aha, there it is. I'm like, really, Lord? He says, yes. I don't know who I'm speaking to this morning. This is just a broad brush of a sermon. I don't know who's got what in their lives, what needs to go. This I can tell you. Don't take too long to decide. Your life hangs in the balance. Satan will come on your shoulder and talk in your ear and tell you, no, you love your arm. Keep it. Keep it. It's bleeding. Bone is shattered. It's nothing. You can't use that arm. The devil says, no. Okay. Think about it. Take your time. Think about it. No, listen. When it's a urgent medical emergency like such a thing like this, you're bleeding, you're on the battlefield, there's all kind of contagions, you can get infected very quickly and easily, we have to tend to you quickly. We need to take care of that matter so we can save your life. And here, as a Christian, as a believer, understand that we have things in our lives. Listen, the scripture says this: for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. You don't know how much time you have. You don't know. You might say to yourself, well, okay, I guess I need to let go of this sin. I guess I need to let go of these friends. But I'm not ready. Let me pray about it. That's the Christian answer for everything. That is the most classic Baptist answer for anything that you personally don't want to do. You already know the answer in your heart. The answer is no. So the Christian says, well, let me pray about it. That's a smokescreen, friends. That means it's no, but I want to stall. Hopefully you forget about it and you won't ask me again. Okay? Let me pray about it. Listen, you don't know if you have time to pray about it. Your life hangs in the balance. What is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. You don't know if you'll be around tomorrow. We don't know if Christ will come tonight. He may come 50 years from now. He may come 100 years from now. He may come only hours from now. We don't know. What is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. Who was shocked months ago when you heard the news on a Sunday afternoon like I did that Kobe Bryant with his daughter and several others died in a helicopter crash along the side of a mountain? Who was shocked? I sure was. What is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. Your life is gone in a moment. Oh, I'm not ready now. I'll think about it. I'll pray about it. And you delay and you default and you wait. And listen to me, while you dither and wait, your life hangs in the balance. Only God in heaven knows how much time you have left. Who was shocked like me on Friday evening, looking at the news on my little phone app, seeing that Chadwick Boseman had passed away from cancer. Who was shocked? I was shocked. 43 years old, a young man. Kobe Bryant, a young man with his daughter. His daughter didn't even get to live her life. Think about that this morning. You don't know how much time you have. You don't know if today is your last day. Listen to me. This morning, if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you've got things that you're holding on to in your life, and you're saying to yourself, you're reasoning in your mind, well, if I get saved and accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, that means I can't live the same way that I have been living. I'd have to get rid of some things, and I'm not ready to do that. I tell you this morning, there's a time factor involved. Your life hangs in the balance. Please, the Bible says, today is the day of salvation. The only moment that you have guaranteed to you this morning is the moment that you sit here before me, hearing the word of God preached to you. This moment is the only moment that is guaranteed you. Listen to me, you don't know if you'll cross the street, get hit by a bullet, hit by a car, if you'll drop dead from some other circumstance. I remember years ago, I was working in Manhattan. I had just recently left college, and I was working somewhere in Midtown, to be precisely. I was working on Lexington and 33rd, and I was on the phones. I was a stockbroker trainee. Remember that, brother? The year was 2001. I had just started that job in August. It was September the 11th. People that morning went to work. They may have fought with their wives before they went. Hopefully they said, I love you, seeing that that was going to be the last time that they would ever see their spouse, see their children again. Again, what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanisheth away. Children going to school. Moms and dads going to work. People had no idea what was about to happen. It happened, it came. Those airplanes, those jets hit the building of the World Trade Center attack. We're coming on another anniversary. We're coming upon another anniversary of the World Trade Center attacks, that terrorist attack, 9/11. Those people, I'm sure, would have liked to have had a little more time with their families. When you want to live, nobody wants to go. But listen to me, we're not going to have an opportunity to decide when our time is. That is in God's hands. Let me tell you this morning, again, the only moment that is guaranteed to you is this moment that you sit in this room today. I tell you, if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as Savior, you do not leave this church until you have a meeting with Christ. You pray. You ask Christ to come into your life and save you. You confess him as your Lord and Savior, acknowledging that he is the Son of God, sinless, the mighty Son of God, and that he went to the cross, gave his life, took nails in his hands, a crown of thorns on his head, went to the cross, and he died for our sins. He died for your sins. And he rose again from the dead. You don't leave this church this morning without having a prayer to Christ that you would receive him and ask him to come into your life. Romans 10:13, the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You call on his name today. You do not delay. There's a time factor involved. Your life hangs in the balance. Your soul hangs in the balance. So often people say, preacher, I'm not ready. I'm not ready. Listen, it's not about your readiness. The date is already set when your time is going to end. And whether you're ready or not, that date will still march on and will meet you. You just make sure that you take advantage of this prime opportunity as you sit in this church. And what you do is, as a humble sinner, you confess your sin to Christ and you ask him to come into your life and save you. I have good news for you. The scripture says that he will receive you as a son. He will receive you as a daughter. Jesus Christ will not refuse you.
you if you come to him. Again, Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you would call upon him, he would not turn his back on you, but rather he would extend to you his loving and benevolent arms, and he will lift you up from the curse of your sin. He will write your name in his kingdom in heaven. He will give you a place in his kingdom in heaven. Call upon him as Savior. Do not delay. Do not wait. I already told you I don't like the scripture. I already told you that. It's too much blood for me. Amen. But it's the decision's too difficult. I have to be honest with you. There have been times in my life I had to say goodbye to a thing. Goodbye to that habit. Good riddance to those friends. Because my goal was to serve Jesus Christ, my Savior. Listen to me. Every one of us will come to those crossroads more than one time in your life. You need to choose Christ every time. Don't keep God waiting. Call upon him for his help. Listen to me. The decision's tough. The decision hurts. Can you imagine? By the way, I did say they had chloroform back in those days in the Civil War. I'd say about 95% of those soldiers had the pain removed. But what about the other 5% when they ran out? Some of them had to feel the whole pain of the amputation. But it saved their life. Listen to me, I'm not here telling you this morning it's not going to hurt. It's going to hurt. But Christ is with you. Make the decision that you need to make. Again, I have no idea who I'm speaking to this morning. But listen to me, again, your life hangs in the balance. Your health as a Christian hangs in the balance. And then, after you said goodbye to that arm, and that hurts. You're not the same man that you were. You're not the same woman that you were. You're missing an arm. You're minus an eye. You're missing a leg. You don't feel whole anymore. You lose your self-esteem. You know, my pastor friend, Pastor Bish, he struggled with that. He joined the group as a pastor with other amputees for counseling. That's a traumatic thing to look in the mirror one day and you've got two arms and two legs, and now you're one leg. And then you walk down the street or you're in a wheelchair. People stare at you. Your life changes. Life changes. And you deal with those consequences, but it was to save your life. It was necessary. Hard decision? Yes. Necessary decision? Oh, so much yes. But think about it, you don't just lose a limb and that's it. Oh no, now you have to figure out how to use those crutches. You lose a leg, now you gotta figure out that wheelchair life. maybe you get a prosthetic. By the way, they had prosthetics back in the 1800s. Because there were so many amputations, they were doing everything from just a peg to mechanical bending limbs and so forth. Technology and prosthetics took leaps and bounds during the Civil War. The whole industry came to be birthed at that time. And you had to learn how to live after the fact. If you lose your right arm, you're going to have to learn to do everything with your left if you're right-handed. Right? I tried that. I tried brushing my teeth with my left. I can't do it. Not that good. I try to write with my left. I can't do it. The only thing I think, I can't, it's hard. You have to learn. You have to adjust. Now, here's what's going to happen. Some of you are going to make the right decision, and you're going to follow Christ. You're going to say goodbye to that bad habit, that bad situation, that sin, whatever the case may be. And then you're not going to know what to do with yourself because you lived with that thing for so long. What do I do now? You have to learn. You need to be rehabbed. You need to get close to Christ. You need to get in the Bible. You need to really read the Bible. Understand the Bible. Let God indeed speak to word, this Bible, the word of God, is God's love letter to his people. Let God speak his love to you, to reassure you, to give you confidence, to rebuild your life after you've gone through the traumatic experience of having something removed, like an arm, a leg, so to speak. Christ can rebuild you and help you. I'm almost done, but, well, I gotta hurry. Amen. Jesus, as he gives this lesson here, he does it in Matthew chapter 5, using the illustration, the arms, the legs, the eyes. He does it again in Matthew 18. And I feel like Jesus is just so nonchalant about it. Ah, whatever, you know, just cut it off, man. Like, no, what do you mean just cut it off? Jesus talks about it like it's no big deal. What's the big deal? It's just an arm, man. But that's my right arm. I love my right arm. Jesus says, don't worry about it. You'll be all right. That's how I feel. Jesus talks about it like it's no big deal. And I wonder, what is that about? And I think I understand. Look here at Matthew. I'm going to skip that scripture. Let's take a look at Revelation. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4 and 5. This is in heaven. Church family, let me remind you that this life is a very temporary situation. We're not here forever. This is not gonna last, okay? We're here today and we're gone. Whereas the grass that withereth, whereas the flower that fadeth. You understand that? What is your life? It's a statue that endures through the generations. No, it's a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. You're not here forever. Our lives are so short. They're so short that when our time it is to die, we don't wanna die. We don't wanna leave this world, leave our loved ones. We didn't have enough time to do the things in life that we wanted to do. It's too short. But understand this, that our real life is in heaven. Amen. It's eternity. It's forever. The life on this earth is comparable to a vapor. It's comparable to a season. The grass that withers, the flower that fades. We're here today and gone tomorrow, and another generation takes our place. Temporary. But the things of God, God's word, God's kingdom, God's heaven, it's forever. And it says here in Revelation chapter 21, verse number 5, it says this, verse 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. You know another thing that's temporary? The tears, the pain. You know, when you're going through the pain seems like it goes on forever. I got good news for you. As much as our lives are as vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away, I want you to also know that our tears are such a thing that when they come down, that our God in heaven sees our tears, and the heart of God is moved with compassion, and God extends himself in his kingdom to us that are there with him. And the Bible says that he wipes away the tears from our eyes. It says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death. We've said goodbye to loved ones. Life has been too short. People have been ripped away from us. Listen to me, in heaven, there's no more death. The Bible says, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. All this stuff that you see in this world, the rioting, the looting, all the former things are passed away. The racism, the injustice, the brutality, the former things are passed away. The pain, the crying and the tears, the death, Jesus says in his word, the former things are passed away. It says in verse number 5, write, for these words are true and faithful. These words are true and faithful. And then one more thing about that. You enter into heaven missing your left arm, missing your right leg, missing your left eye. It says here in verse number 5, and he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. Behold,
I make all things new. Listen to me. In this life, you're going to say goodbye to things. Let go of things. Listen to me. God in heaven will restore you everything. You'll be whole. You'll have two arms again. Two feet. Two eyes. The deaf will hear. Amen. The blind will see. There'll be no more sorrow. Again, no more sorrow. There's no sickness in heaven. We have people in our church that are afflicted by health issues, chronic, and they're suffering, and it's tough. Listen to me. There ain't going to be no more of that in heaven. Glory to God. Jesus said, listen to me. Don't worry about it. What are you worried about that right arm for? Hey, stop being so dramatic. We're so dramatic, right? To me, it's not dramatic. That's a big deal. My right arm, I'm going to live without my right arm. I'm going to make it. I don't know. I can't do it. Oh, I'm going to write. How am I going to brush my teeth? How am I going to eat? I can't do it. No, Lord, I can't say goodbye to my right arm. Jesus says, stop being a big baby. I'm going to give it back to you in heaven. Jesus looks at us and is like, what are you worried about? Don't you believe that my heaven is real, that my kingdom is real, that it's forever and ever, that in this kingdom, there is nothing that defileth, there's no pain, no death. The former things are passed away. Don't you believe that? What are you worried about your leg for? What are you worried about your eye for? What are you worried about your arm for? As long as you get into heaven, man, you're good.
Amen.
Glory to God. As long as your name is written in the book of life, you're good. And he'll restore you. I said I was going to skip the scripture, and I just remembered that there's something important in the scripture that I said I was going to skip that I have to give you this morning. Look at Matthew chapter 19. So just a couple pages over. Matthew 19, verse 28 and 29. I want to pick out something real quick for you here. It says, and Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye also shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone that hath forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my name's sake, shall receive an hundredfold, and shall inherit everlasting life. There's one word I want to just pick out of all of that. It says here in verse 28, it says, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration. In the regeneration. Matthew chapter 19, verse 28. In the regeneration. You said goodbye to an arm, and God will regenerate to you another arm. You said goodbye to a leg, God will regenerate another leg. In God's kingdom, in the regeneration, your body's going to be whole. It's going to be new. Those of you, we have a few senior people here, and you have aches and pains. Listen to me. No more pain. Glory to God. No more aches.
Amen.
Only health. I'm not sure if we're going to have gray hair in heaven. I'm not even sure if we're going to have gray hair in heaven. We'll be the perfect picture of youth and health and glory in God's kingdom. I'm going to close the message this morning with one little story that some of you might even know. A couple years ago, there was a movie made, about 10 years ago. The movie was called 127 Hours. Ever heard of that movie, anybody? In this movie, you had a young man by the name of Aaron Ralston, who was a pretty good rock climber, and one day he decided to take a climb by himself. Ill-advisedly, he made a huge mistake. He forgot to tell anybody where he was going and when he was supposed to come back. Forgot to tell somebody. He was climbing out there in the state of Utah and those mountains out there, beautiful country. I've never been out there. I've seen pictures. Bro, Casa, you been out there?
Right.
No, never. Oh, we're taking that trip together. Okay. On the Rocky Mountains or and the such. He's climbing out there and he messes up. He slips. He falls and he gets his hand pinned under a boulder. He's trapped. No one knows where he is and he doesn't know what to do. For the ensuing hours, he's trying to do different things. He tried to do a pulley system, try to pull the boulder off of him, but it could not work. He tried everything he could, and for 127 hours, you do the math how many days that is, he was trapped there. He started to hallucinate, and he was starting to lose hope. He's dehydrated and so on. He doesn't know what to do. In all of his hallucinating, he had a vision. A strange vision, actually. He's a single man. And he had a vision that he had a child, a son, and that he had a spouse. And when he came to his mind, he got inspired to try yet one more thing to save his life there. And now, having been inspired to understand that there was a future awaiting him, that maybe I could get out of this alive. Maybe one day I will get married and find love. Maybe one day I will have a child. He gets inspired and he figures out a way to free himself. First, what he does is he twists his arm and breaks the bone in his arm. He does that. You have to be all kinds of inspired to do that with your own force. And he did it. Who here has the strength to do that? I don't. I don't have the mental strength to do that. He did it. God gave him the strength. Maybe God gave him that vision so that he would have the fortitude in his heart to do such a thing. He pushed and pushed and snapped his arm. Snapped his arm. And then he took out of his backpack something to do a tourniquet to cut off the blood flow. Then he took his all-purpose knife and started to cut. No painkiller, nothing. Started to cut. He cut himself free. He got out to the side of the road. He saw someone. He called for help. Saved his life. To this day, he did get married. He does have a child. Saved his life. And he's rich too, because the movie was made about his story, man. So he's got money too now. Amen. That helps, amen. Oh, if I can't have my hand, at least I got a little money. Okay? Tough decision. But it saved his life. It saved his life. And that's the point. In our Christian walk, we have tough decisions. Things we have to say goodbye to. Pastor, who told you about me? Nobody. I didn't know anything. I don't know anybody who has that decision to make. I don't know. This is what the Lord laid on my heart. Again, I say to you, never in my entire life have I had a desire to preach about cutting off arms. Never. But the Lord said, today's the day. You're going to preach about that. I don't know who has to make a decision. But listen to me. I'll tell you this. We're going to have soul winning next Saturday. We've got folks in our church who've been soul winning. Listen to me, don't play games with God, amen? Soul winning is a command. You don't think the pastor knows that people are slacking off now that we stopped having church? Now people don't want to go to church anymore, amen? Listen to me, God's going to hold us accountable. The time is short and the kingdom of God is at hand. We need to serve him, amen? We need to get serious about serving Christ. You don't know when the end of your life is going to be. Don't waste what you have today, right here and right now. Cherish these moments. Cherish these days. Don't say in your life, well, later I'll live for the Lord. Maybe in years from now. No. You don't know if you have years. You don't know. Again, this is to save somebody's life. I don't know who you are this morning, but listen to me. Make that decision today. Don't keep Christ waiting. He loves you. He wants the best for you. Oh, God must hate us because he wants us to make these tough decisions. And like, no. He's trying to save your life. This message is because we care for you, because God cares for you. That's why this message is here. The Lord knows better than anybody what's in your heart and what's going on. And we need to come to Christ with everything that we have. We need to come to him with everything that we have. Don't keep him waiting. Don't keep him waiting. At this time, we're going to have prayer. We're going to do business with God. I don't know what business you need. Some of us,
to confess sin to him. You know, the Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Confess to him. He will not refuse you. Confess to him. Christ will receive you as his own. Before you are his own, he will forgive you. Some of us, you're carrying weight. The weight of the past. Emotional trauma. Emotional pain. You need to cut that off and give that to Christ. Cut it off and cast it from you. It's to save your life. Memories. Cut it off. Cast it from you. Run to Christ. The Bible says, draw nigh to God. He will draw nigh to you. The Lord waits for you. Everything they need medically, the doctor stands ready to perform to the best of his ability. That is the Hippocratic oath that they take to serve the patient, to serve humanity. There's yet a greater oath, which is from Christ, which is to say, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you will call upon him, he will save you. If you would lean on him, he will support you. If you fall upon him, he will lift you up. If you pray to him, he will hear you. If you are hurting, he will heal you. If you are in sorrow, he will comfort you and lift you up and make you strong again. He will rehabilitate you and make you whole again. You may be without an arm. You may be without a leg. But you can live life happier and stronger and do more for Christ with him in your life. Minus those things. And in God's kingdom in heaven, he'll make you whole. We're going to have our invitation. I invite you to come forward to pray. We'll do as we have done in the current weeks, as you know, we just take small groups and we pray together. Families praying together, brothers and sisters praying together, spouses praying together. Listen to me, this is the house of prayer, and in this generation we need prayer. We need among you of God's people, I encourage you, as you pray for your family and your children, please also pray for this country. Please pray for the lost. Please pray for this church. If you can find it in your heart, I humbly ask that you would even pray for me. I want you to know, as your preacher, I do pray for you. Listen to me. We're to confess our faults one to another and pray for one another that we might be healed. We need healing. We need renewal. God bless you. Let us take some time together and pray. For those of you who haven't been with us, you don't know what to do, you can pray right there in your seat. You can come forward. There are no rules. The only rule is to pray, and to pray to Christ. That's the only rule. And we'll just have a few minutes of that, and then we'll soon bring our service to a close.
Let him not miss out on any more blessing that you have for him. Oh, Lord God, I pray that you.
I came for the first time, and we want to say welcome to you. We have a second. Oh, there's Nathaniel. Hi, Nathaniel. Just want to introduce you to everybody. Public. It's his first time, and He's there in the back in the orange shirt, first time. Do we have any other first-time guests? First-time guests, and then also...
We might next week again.
Also, we have so many people that got away too. All right, so we have other guests, but people are moving around, and so if they come back in, we'll recognize them. But in the meantime, we'll sing one more song before we go. We'll sing a wonderful song here, Blessed Assurance. If you can find your song sheet, if you can dig it out, we'll sing one more before we head on our way home this afternoon. Let us sing, Blessed Assurance, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, precious of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. We're going to have our closing prayer. Let me ask Brother Cassio to come, lift his voice with the microphone, and close us in prayer.
Let's give God our honor. We've had 63 here in attendance.
Oh, praise God.
Praise God.
That's a high.
37 in the deaf
ministry. That's another high.
It's another high. We're going to have the largest deaf ministry in New York, I'm telling you. Trust the hearing. Let us pray. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus, the mighty name. Lord, we pray now as we go about our things, busyness this week, Lord, you give everyone here traveling mercies, a hedge around them, protect them, Lord. Give them wisdom, know how to handle themselves here in this coronavirus environment. Give them health, Lord, and above all, prosper them so your work can go forward. We ask now that you bless everyone here. Bless our pastor now as he go about praying for next week's service and visitation and everything he has to do. And let's just be mindful of what Pastor said. Soul winning is an obligation. Go ye out. It's a commandment. It's not an option. So next Saturday, let's all come together in unity, Family Baptist Church, in our traditions, and go out soul winning, passing out tracts, and inviting people to come to hear the word of God. There's famine in the land, my friends. There's famine in the land, but it's for the word of God. Churches are closed. They're trying to close down Christian ministries. But they want all the bars open and all of that. So we are fighting against evil forces now. So let us be aware that God has won the war, but we rage in the battle for souls, for the kingdom of God. Thank you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed. Don't forget about Saturday and next Sunday both. Give me 1 second.